Hello, hello, hello. Hi, everyone. Sky, you're 3 minutes late. Shut the fuck up. No, really, I was prepping. I wasn't even prepping stuff. I was just going over things, and I completely lost track of time. And when I looked up, it was 11:30, and I'm like, quickly, quickly now. So, the title. We shall talk about the title first. I thought the order was for the game was Karma was first. I was wrong. You're supposed to like do Rod first. And so we're gonna do Rod's route, but fair warning, if we see anything from find some information from Karma's route, just pretend like we haven't heard it before. Okay, in my defense, a lot of Rod's route has to do with the castle, and so I thought he was with the other castle people, but he's not. My bad. But after Rod, it's Rumple, so. But yeah, so. Fun fact. Yeah, I'm a dumbass. I should have checked before I started, but I did not because I'm me. What was I gonna say? I'm checking the stream on my phone, make sure everything's running right and working right. Well, and I think we are going to go through some duplicates. We're not going through the entirety of the prologue again. I believe we are legitimately, let me check. Yeah, we are on chapter one. So the reasoning for this is I was going to go to, like, the options. But actually, apparently, Rod has an option even earlier than I thought. So I was like, oh, damn it. We're going to do some skipping this route. But it's fine. It's going to be chill. It's going to be good. We get to see new dialogue, you know? It's going to be great. Sorry, as I yawn. Hi, it's going interestingly. I was late. I lost track of time. Double checking things. And so I ended up being a few minutes late. It's fine though. I'm about to get started into the game because, yeah. Oh, sorry. I just remembered because I saw the coloring. I've learned a fun fact today. So yellow school buses, when they were originally coming up with the idea for them, they were like, okay, well, we want something to where kids aren't, you know, in danger. So what should we do? And so they were like, ah, let's paint the school buses yellow. Which, like, yeah, fair enough, you know, you can see that. However, the original color they used was very toxic. It had lead in it. It's like, ah, yes, we shall make the kids safer by making it more dangerous. Hey, bus crashes, and bus accidents went down. People dying from lead went up. I just found that such an interesting and fun fact. I follow this person. I can't remember her name off the top of my head right now, but she deals with a lot of paints and especially older paints. She did one of like one of the very first colors was actually like in paints was pink, surprisingly enough. It was really interesting. She's very interesting to watch. But yeah, game. So this actually is a Rod choice. I didn't realize that. I just thought, whatever. So, last time we did this, so we have to do this. You... Yeah, she is. She's super fun. Every time she pops up on my, like, shorts feeds and in my recommendations, it's always a fun time. You hate me. You have no right to start acting like the victim now. Not when you've treated my family with such disrespect. Oh, you bastard. Sorry. I know something. And I know that this... Keep this moment in mind, because this moment gets rewritten later on that makes you go, oh, you bitch! Not when you've treated my family with such disrespect. The only reason I didn't say anything before is because Emily didn't want me to. I'm happier too, now that you're gone. I don't have to pretend to like you anymore. I'm going to return to the palace now. I'm gone and they're all happier. Oh yeah, so let's skip their sad Lucienne hours. I love the lilies in the corner blooming. Yay, we get to skip through Rumple. We don't have to- Oh, damn it. No, we don't get to skip through Rumple. Ah. Yeah. Last time, I think I stayed silent. Fuck him. Can I throw the tray? Oh no, I probably didn't actually. I'm tempted to let you. Feisty as well. Oh, be still, my beating heart. Huh? You. He's a weak. He is. And we're gonna skip. Oh no. The car road rumble. I was trying to avoid all this skipping, I swear to you, but I hate that that happened to be a choice. I feel like for any of the other choices, I might just skip to the decisions so we don't have to skip so much. Oh, the effects are so wonky in the skip. Ah, here we go. Rod. New dialogue, finally! Rod came to the Marchin today to discuss something with Parfait. This is just the third time he has visited the tavern since I've been here. I wonder what he discusses with Parfait. Rod's eyebrows furrow as soon as he sees me enter the room. Oh. Oh. Wrong person! Oh, it seems like the princess has something she would like to speak with you about, Prince Rod. She probably already knows why I'm here. Thank you, Prince Rod, for telling me about this. I shall leave you with the princess now. Rod's expression turns grim. He clearly disapproves of me even just being in the same room as him. As soon as Parfait leaves, he shoots a glare in my direction. Why did we save this path? Why did we save him in Karma's playthrough? We shouldn't have. Damn you. What do you want? All I have done is enter the room and he is already angry. I'm still not used to being treated like this by him. I'm here to ask you about goodness. You're asking the wrong person, Luciette. You are. Did I make the right choice in choosing to come to him? Oh no, absolutely not. I do not intend to help you break your curse, no matter what Lady Parfait says. Pardon? Emily and my mother have tried to be kind to you many times, but you've only ever responded with disrespect. You bastard! Sorry. I don't want to spoil, but at the same time, it's like, You don't get to say that. You don't get to be like that. You, oh my gosh. Cruelty. You think I have been cruel to them? How else would you describe your behavior? Why am I suddenly the one at fault? Their coming to the palace made my life miserable. I'm the victim here, not them. Others may think you're capable of goodness, but I severely doubt it. I do not wish to work with you, so do not come to me for help. Excuse me. He turns around and begins to walk away, leaving me to stand alone in the room, even angrier than I was before. I'm angry for you, Lucia, because I know shit you don't know, and I'm angry because, like, you little... How dare he treat me like that? Same! Also, Lucia, you're not a victim, but... Well, you are a victim, but also... It's complicated. Like, Ophelia and Amelia didn't do anything to you, but they did have an impact on you that was negative. I don't think she was really cruel to them, though. She just kind of ignored them and didn't respect them as princess and queen. Which, given she's the crown princess, first of all, her mother was the queen, and she's still in this timeline very much, my mother was correct on everything. Kind of fair! I grab his arm and I pull him around so that he is facing me. Oh. I refuse to let him belittle me like this, especially when I am making a conscious effort to change. What if I can help you break your curse? Will you help me then? Rod fixes me with icy stare as he pulls away. I do not intend to break my curse. What? Rod shoots me one last glare before he leaves the mansion, leaving me to stand there confused. If he does not intend to break his curse, then why is he even here? I stare in horror at the floor. Oh, yeah, this we already know. I would use this button, but as we saw last time, that was a very dangerous option, so we're not going to use the button. Let's ask Rod again! Oh, he's gonna hate us. I glance over at Rod as he enters the tavern. That was almost perfect timing, Lucia. He told me that he does not intend to break his curse, yet here he is again. Rod must sense my eyes on him, because the minute he walks in, he turns to look at me. His expression is cold and unmoving, as always. He pointedly leaves the tavern area and enters the reception. I follow after him. I told you to find someone else. What can I do to make you stop hating me? What? You said that whatever I had done to you or your family was bad. So if I reverse that, I might get a good deed. You truly don't understand how goodness works, do you? No, motherfucker! Her mother was a bitch! She doesn't understand purely because of her mother! I would not be asking you if I did. Rod closes his eyes and rubs the back of his neck. He looks thoughtful, but also irritated. I intend to break my curse as soon as possible, and I will do whatever it takes. And it seems to me the easiest way to achieve a good deed is to fix the supposedly bad things I have already done. So are you going to help me or not? Tell Lady Parfait I will see her another time. That's streaming. So far good. It's going good so far. There's been a little bit of skipping because Rod stupidly has a thing that's all the way at the beginning. So I've had to skip, but at least we're on new dialogue. Kind of. He leaves the room without answering my question. I ball my hands into fists. And he calls me the cruel one. Also, Lucia hates Rod, which is kind of fair, and Rod hates her, which... Kind of fair, but also... A little bit hypocritical of him. And that will be explained why later. A month has passed, and I have yet to complete even one good deed. Not for a lack of trying, though. I've been asking to receive various things. Her mother being an asshole. And now we finally get to the choice. How do I stop you skipping? There we go. Finally. right. Rod. Chapter 3. A change of pace. I will ask Rod if he will pair up with me. This guy has repeatedly said, "Hey, I fucking hate you." And her response is, "We shall pair up together." I know we do not have a good relationship, at least she's aware. Rod has spared no effort in telling me how cruel I have been to his family. But I feel that rectifying whatever mistakes I've made with them might be an easy way to get 3 good deeds. Oh, this is gonna be very interesting. Well, Lucia, didn't he tell you that he didn't want to break his curse? That's how you make best friends. That's how you make best friends. Yes, but that may not be the whole truth. He's still reluctant to break his curse despite all the advice I've offered him. Perhaps you will be able to encourage him where I could not. Oh yeah, I remember. I do not care if he does not want to break his curse. I only need him to help me remedy the supposedly bad things I've done to his family. I believe that will be the easiest way to break my curse. The problem is, I rarely see him here. He is usually at the palace. In order for this arrangement to work, I need to be in the palace. I, for one, think it's a terrible idea! What if... Laura's voice trails off. She averts her gaze to the floor, her expression a mixture of anxiety and solemn consideration. Oh yeah. Yeah, this is why Rod's route was supposed to be first. Moments like this of like, oh, I wonder whatever she could possibly be contemplating. It couldn't be the Ten Bearer or anything. This is why we play things in order. What if what? Is there something I should know? Both witch and fairy stare at me silently. After a few moments, Parfait speaks. You would be far away from us, princess. We would not be able to assist you. Witches could be lying in wait for you, knowing that you are the true crown princess of Angelia. They might seek to use you for their own purposes. What sort of purposes? Why would the witches be after me in the first place? Many of them have been corrupted by the Ten. Darkness has invaded their hearts, making them bitter. Like a certain ice princess. Many of them simply want to see the fairy tale curses continue on undisturbed. This is all speculation, but it's better to be safe than sorry. I love how good they are at trying to gaslight Lucia into like, oh, they just want you for normal reasons. No special reason at all. What? Never. What would you have me do? Delora. I have an idea. I think I can get her into the palace and make sure there's someone there to look out for her. How? Just trust me. Tomorrow the Ice Princess returns to her palace. I have a bad feeling about this. You should. Oh, I forgot her sprite changes! Look at that! Hell yeah! This cannot be happening. Don't dilly-dally. The princess will soon be awake and expecting her new maid. I close my eyes and suppress the urge to groan. How's it that Delora was able to turn me into Emily's personal maid? She thought this would be funny, did she? Well, I will make her pay for this. I expect you not to be late again. We have very strict rules on how the palace staff should behave. I want to point out something. She says this, and one of the reasons people hate Luciette is the fact that she kicked out a maid for ripping her doll's dress, and yet they're like, yeah, we have very strict rules on how we should behave. How's Luciette the bad one here? Run that by me again? The maid not only touched a personal object of the princesses, the crown princesses, and she might have had permission. Let's be real, we don't know. However, she touched it, she tore it, and given how protective Luciette was of those dolls, them being her only friends, her only prized possessions, I think it's safe to say that she told the palace maids, hey, take utmost care with them. utmost, careful with them. But everyone's mad at her because, oh, how dare she kick out that maid.
Huh? Huh? What?
I don't know. Stupid. It's stupid. It's just something that's always rubbed me, like, confused, because it's like, I understand they're trying to paint Lucia as uncaring, but in the terms of Anise, I don't think she was wrong for what she did. Like, she was well and within her right, as Crown Princess, to fire the maid that broke one of her prized possessions. Like, what? I'm not exactly sure how Dolora managed this. She told me she was going to cast a spell on me, and that it would be over as soon as I opened my eyes. I closed my eyes, and sure enough, when I opened them, I found myself here in a maid uniform. What did she do? The maid continues to blabble to me. How annoying. I pretend to listen to her as she leads me through the palace halls. Emily and Rod's chambers are located here. Oh! We come to a halt when Emily suddenly appears from around the corner. Your Highness. The maid ducks into a neat curtsy. Emily's eyes meet mine. I tense and wait for any signs of recognition from her, but she only gives me a curious look, as if wondering who I am. She clearly does not recognize me. The maid suddenly reaches back and pulls on my shoulder, forcing me into a bow. You're in front of the Crown Princess of Angelia. Show some respect, girl. My apologies, Your Highness. She is new and clearly needs to be taught some manners. Excuse me? Oh, please, there's no need for that. What is she trying to achieve by pretending to be kind to a palace maid? Who is she trying to fool? Your Highness, this is your new personal maid. Emily glances at the maid, looking confused. Why do I need a personal maid? It is by the king's order, princess. Emily turns to look at me again. What is your name? She's talking to you, girl. I scowl at the maid before facing Emily. I cannot believe I've fallen so low that I am now being ordered around by a maid. Luciette. It's nice to meet you, Luciette. I hope we can get along. When I do not respond, Emily's face falls flat. I was just heading to breakfast with my family. Of course, Luciette will escort you to the dining hall. I raise my eyebrows at the maid, irritated. There's no need for concern. I can get there on my own. I breathe a sigh of relief. I'm not here to babysit her. The maid leans forward and whispers something in my ear. I don't know how it is that you landed this position, but you owe the royal family your diligence and respect. If you continue to show disrespect, I will be having a word with the king. The maid pushes me forward so that I am forced to stand next to Emily. You know what's crazy? Going through this route and then remembering the prologue. Because if you remember in the prologue, Luciette walked to the dining hall alone. She did not have a maid with her. In fact, she overheard two maids gossiping and told them off for it. And yet Emily, you know, can't go anywhere without her personal maid. They're all here like, yeah, we go by strict rules, but only when we like our employer. Like, wait a minute. She will escort you to the dining hall, Your Highness. Her job requires that she follows you everywhere in case you require assistance with anything. Granted, Luciette might have kicked a maid away from her or pushed them away, but like, if that were the case, there wouldn't be any maids, period. And she didn't fire the maids that were gossiping, you notice. So, But it's almost time for breakfast, Princess Amelia. Amelia frowns and looks at me. I'm so sorry. What is she apologizing for? Good morning. Good morning. It seems you have met your personal maid. Rod! The king's eyes widen as soon as he spots me. You look familiar. Does he recognize me? No, he remembers you as the girl that I kicked out. I feel a little tremble in my heart as I consider that hope. Are you not the girl who came to- told you. To the gates before. I deflate with a soundless sigh. He remembers me as the peasant. This is the first time I'm meeting you as Amelia's personal maid. What is your name? Nuciet. That is a lovely name. Whoa, what was the pause there, my dude? We are glad to have you here, Nuciet. The king gives me a warm smile. The softness of his gaze makes me angry. He never treated me so kindly when he remembered me as his own daughter. And Rod wonders! Rod's like, damn, you treated my family, meanly. And why? This, my guy. He treated everyone with, like, happiness and respect, but her? Her, nah. Emily takes her seat while I walk to stand at the walls beside the other maids and butlers. The door opens and Rod walks inside. He greets the king, Ophelia, and then his sister. He's just about to take a seat when his eyes suddenly fall on me. The shock is apparent on his face. Rod, is something wrong? I see there's a new maid on the staff. His tone is almost accusatory. I bristle at his words and about to say something when Ophelia speaks. She is Emily's new personal maid, Nuciet. Rod stares at me for a few moments, his expression unreadable. Eventually, he moves to take a seat. I feel like Rod took the moment of, oh, damn it, she snuck in here, heard that of Emily's personal maid, and realized, nah, this was Delora. this was not her. I stand silent and watch the royal family eat their breakfast. The small area is filled with happy conversation. The four of them smile at each other when they speak, and it is easy to see how comfortable they are with one another. When I was still here, our meals were always so quiet, but everyone looks so happy now. I bite my lip to will the heavy feeling away. Rod told me that before, but I did not want to believe him. I turn back to the conversation at hand. We have something very important to discuss with you, Emily. Uh-oh? I have brought this up before, but now the matter is more pressing. Is it about... Yes, this is about the ball. Ophelia gives the king a disapproving look. Dear, I know it seems like a strange proposition, but this is a royal tradition. Emily is at a suitable marrying age, and this ball may yet help her find a suitor. But a husband? Emily's cheeks are tinted pink. A royal ball for Emily? For her to find a husband? I never would have agreed to such a thing. The king never forced me into one because he knew that. I will not force you to marry someone you do not love, Emily. We agreed on this ball to uphold tradition. All eligible bachelors will be invited in 4 months' time, and you will choose the man you want to court you. I did find my true love through a ball, after all. He glances at Ophelia, who responds with a fond smile. Her expression falls back to something more worried as she looks at her daughter. But what if I can't choose anyone? We will throw one ball, as per tradition. We will not force you into another ball if you do not find a good suitor. But we must uphold traditions at least once. Perhaps this will push you to think more about the future. Oh, I forgot how crazy this was too. Because, like, Nuciet very clearly seems like she was upholding her role as crown princess. She legitimately was doing everything that she was supposed to do as crown princess. But for Emily, who's just now kind of been pushed into this position, she's failing, would you believe? And it's interesting to see that difference between them. While Nuciet did it with confidence and pure, like, knowing, basically being, what's the word? Raised. She was literally raised for the position. Emily is floundering. She's a fish out of water here. I will not put any added pressure on you, Emily, but I would be happy to see grandchildren before I give up my throne. I am not getting any younger, you know. Father! I can tell that the king is trying to make light of the situation, but there's an undertone of seriousness. Emily eventually sighs and then slowly nods. I understand. My gaze shifts to Rod in search for a reaction, but his expression is impassive. No reaction at all. Did he know this was going to happen? But can I really be the princess of the kingdom of Angelia deserves? I feel so unprepared. You are. You're the crown princess of Angelia. You must be confident. Emily looks down, looking genuinely distressed. I'm finished. May I be excused? But sweetheart, you've barely touched your food. You may. Amelia stands up and ducks into a quick curtsy before rushing from the room. I do not move until I feel Rod's glare on me. I realize that I am meant to follow Amelia. Excuse me. I curtsy and follow after Amelia. I barely make it a few steps from the dining hall before the door flies open and Rod is rushing after me. What are you doing here? Avoid the question or answer him. Well, okay, this... So, I feel like avoiding is just not gonna do anything, honestly. So I feel like answering him, because I feel like if we avoid the question, he's going to blame us and be like, you snuck in here. I'm here to break my curse. You expect me to believe that when you had people offering to help at the marchin? Rod's expression changes, anger clear in his eyes. No, I know why you're really here. What are you talking about? You thought you might take back what is rightfully yours, don't you? You have no qualms about hurting my family again. I stare him, nonplussed by his actions. I carefully quell the shimmering anger inside me. The last thing I want is to be fired before I break my curse. I am not here to hurt anyone, so stop accusing me of such things. We glare at each other in silence. I always thought that Rod was closed off and quiet, but his emotions are always blazing in his eyes. You shouldn't be here. Rod steps back, but his gaze is still fierce. I do not have time for this. I'm going to find Amelia. Why, so you consult her? No, because it is my job to attend to her. Excuse me. The last place I expect to find Amelia is in the throne room. Much to my surprise, I find her standing alone inside, staring up at the throne. Oh, when she turns to face me, she has a guilty expression on her face. I'm sorry. What is she apologizing for? I was very rude earlier, walking out on everyone at breakfast. Amelia gazes back at the throne and sighs. I'm sure any other girl would be happy to have a ball. I mean, it's like something out of a fairy tale. Yeah, it is. But I... She sighs once again and looks down at her clasped hands. It all sounds so perfect in the fairy tales. 3 days is all it takes before everyone's found their true love. But I don't think that's how it works in a... Blah, blah, blah. But I don't think that's how it works out in real life. Do you? I have nothing to say in response when Amelia turns her beseeching gaze to me. I don't know how I'm supposed to marry someone I barely even know. Is this really what it means to be crown princess? Isn't this precisely what you wanted? Excuse me? When your mother married the king, you became a princess. You went from rags to riches overnight. I cannot keep the bitterness in my voice. Bitterness from my voice when I speak. Your life is playing out like Cinderella, is it not? All you are missing are the glass slippers, and even then I'm sure the king could arrange for a pair. I cannot understand why you're so unhappy. Neither can I. Because this isn't what you wanted. Oh. Emily turns away from me to face the throne once more, and in the sun that steams through the windows, I see something shining on her cheeks. Is she crying? I am so ungrateful. Luciette, what would you do?
What?
If you were in my place, if you became crown princess overnight, would you go through with the ball? For the sake of Angelia's tradition, for the sake of your role, I would never do anything so worthless. The king never brought up the subject with me. He most likely knew I would have refused. I love how Lucette's not wrong here. Like, Emily is genuinely asking, hey, what would you do? And she's like, I wouldn't go. And Emily's like, oh, so you understand. It's like, no. The difference between it is that Lucia is confident enough, and the king knows damn well that she will fulfill her job as crown princess without traditions, without the ball. Granted, the king also just sucks as a dad, to be honest. But Emily, meanwhile, is kind of a people pleaser and is going to go along with things she's not comfortable with. Meanwhile, Lucette, who isn't a people pleaser by any means, was confident to say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this. I will fulfill my duties. I don't need to do this, not for the sake of tradition, because I do not feel comfortable with it. And that difference is what's the biggest, like, I don't know, the differences between them, I guess. I could do with some fresh air. Shall we go to my friend's shop in town? We have only just exited the throne room when Emily stops short and I almost bump into her back. Oh.
Oh, hi. Hi.
Your Highness, what a pleasant... Sir Mythos abruptly stops to stare at me. Why is Sir Mythos looking at me so intently? Is something the matter, Sir Mythos? No, nothing at all, Your Highness. I'm just amused. Fuck off! Oh, is that the princess? Why is she a maid? Man! Amused? Oh, you haven't met my new maid. This is Lucette. Lucette? There's something in Sir Mythos' gaze that I do not trust. The silence is stifling as I curtsy at him. Sir. Charming. Fucker. Again, we gotta ignore the information we already have. Sir Mythos turns his attention back to Emily. Where are you off to this pleasant day? Oh, just off to visit a friend. Make sure you bring your guards with you, princess. Of course. I wonder what's taking him so long. Emily decided to invite Rod to join us on her visit. One of the guards offered to get Rod for her, but he has still yet to return. Another stands with us by the gates, ready to escort us into town. Why does the king even keep these incompetent fools if they cannot find a single person? You know, given how useless the guards were in Karma's route, fair. Maybe we should go look for Rod. But then, what if he gets here as soon as we go searching for him? I sigh. I will go look for him. You can stay here. But you don't need to run errands for me. She has yet to ask me to do anything. What does she think a maid even does? I look at her sullenly, not answering her. Finally, she relents. Thank you, Lucette. I incline my head slightly before walking off. I feel like a babysitter. I cannot believe I have to search for Rod. This is only slightly better than being dragged around by that broom. I turn around the corner and nearly bump into someone. I take a few steps back just in time. Princess. Hi, Fitz. Hold on. It's a little jarring, okay? Like, freaking yesterday, we watched this man die. Give me a second. Fitz, you're alive! How you doing, buddy? I look up in shock. Fitz's surprise mirrors my own. Where have you been? I've been looking for you everywhere. He pauses to stare at my clothing. Why are you wearing a maid's uniform? Fitz, you remember who I am. I would never forget you, Princess Lucette. But it does seem like I'm the only one who remembers you. What is going on, Princess? The only people who remember me are witches, fairies, and
Fitz, are you? I stop when I hear the sound of approaching footsteps. Fitz turns at the sound and then stoops low into a form of bow when he sees Rod. Your Highness. Rod's impassive face twists with annoyance when he sees me. Rod does not even acknowledge Fitz as he walks past him to stop in front of me. Shouldn't you be attending to my sister? I don't understand. Prince Rod, do you know why the princess is dressed like that? Like this? Rod is clearly just as surprised as I am that Fitz remembers me. You recognize her. You remember the princess too. But if you knew, why didn't you say anything when she first went missing? And can someone explain to me why she's attending to Princess Emily? This is Fitz. I cut him off before he can ask any more questions. I feel Rod's gaze on my back as I turn to look at Fitz. No more questions. But Princess, right now I'm a palace maid. A what? It is a long story, and I have no time to explain now, so do not ask. Fitz is clearly discontent. He seems to struggle for a few moments before he finally sighs and nods. Yes, Your Highness. Though it is nice to hear someone here speak my title, it will not do if Fitz calls me that by accident. It is just Luciette for now. But I turn to face Rod. Emily is waiting. What? The guard could not even deliver her message? Where are you going? Emily wants to visit her friend's shop in town, and she wants you to go with us, Rod. Town? Ordinarily, I would not mind Fitz joining us, but right now he might just be unnecessary company. He may very well give me away. Rod barely wants to speak with me when it's just the two of us. I doubt Fitz will make him more sociable. I'm assuming that accompanying you is not an option at this point. Yes. Fitz looks down a moment before looking at Rod. I'm sorry to ask this of you, Your Highness, but since she refuses to let me do so, please look after Princess Luciette in my place. Ridiculous. I do not need to be coddled. Even if I did, Rod couldn't care less if I am hurt. I will do my best, Sir Fritzgard. I cannot tell if he is being genuine or not. Fitz bows to both of us. Stay safe, Luciette. And you, Your Highness. Rod turns and begins to walk away without another word. Come on. Rod is silent as we make our way back to the palace gates. I am still thinking about what he said to Fitz earlier. Why would Rod agree to Fitz's request? Because he just wanted him to leave? I stare at Rod's back as he walks in front of me. Sometimes I cannot figure out what he is thinking. Rod, Luciette! Amelia beams when she catches sight of us. Are you ready? Rod crosses his arms. He does not look very happy with his sister. Even though Rod is younger, I cannot help but think he often sounds like the older of the two. I am busy, Emily. I can't keep dropping everything whenever you want to leave the palace. I'm sorry, but I just really needed some fresh air today. You can get plenty of fresh air on the palace grounds. I felt like I needed to be off the palace grounds. Emily's face drops as she looks at the ground. Rod lets out an exasperated sigh before stepping inside the carriage. Come on. Rod? Just for an hour, okay? Thank you. I soon come to realize that it is easier to walk around town now that everyone has forgotten who I am. The atmosphere around town feels brighter. All the spiteful stares are gone. Princess Emily. Oh, how are you doing? Is your wife feeling better? Emily has responded to most people who know her. She seems to know a good majority of people in town. Well, she didn't grow up in the town. I hang back as Emily speaks with the man. The night escort hovers somewhere nearby, watching for disturbances. We are going to take longer than an hour if she continues like this. I'm not going to rush her. Don't you need to return to the palace to continue whatever work it is you were doing? Rod raises an eyebrow at me. I do have to get back to my studies, but my family always comes first. If this makes Emily happy, then I will gladly come with her to town. It's a small thing. Happy. I look more closely at Emily. She's smiling, but then she always smiles. I do not understand. She is more at ease talking to the townspeople sometimes because they don't judge her. Why would she have to worry about being judged? It is clear that everyone adores her. Emily takes the man's hand in hers as she wishes him well. Rod points out the gesture. See that? That's goodness.
I love Rod. This is the equivalent of the blind leading the blind right now. Rod's like, I don't know how to be good. Emily's the good one. Lucyette's like, I don't know how to be good. You're better than me.
Oh no.
You can learn something from my sister, Lucyette. Is goodness pretending to be interested in strangers' lives?
Lucyette!
Emily eventually says her goodbyes before walking toward a familiar store. This is the toy shop I visited with Emily and Rod before. I glance at Rod and notice the expression on his face. He seems conflicted. But why? But before I can ask, Rod marches in front of me and decisively pushes open the door. When I enter, Emily is already hugging the shop girl, Victoria. Emily, you look as beautiful as ever. Oh please, I look the same. You, on the other hand. Emily steps back before nodding, a bright smile on her face. Being in love suits you. When is the wedding? Wedding? She is already engaged. I catch a small movement out the corner of my eyes and turn to glance at Rod. I notice his fingers clench into a fist before he quickly hides his hand behind his neck. Or behind his back. Though his expression is as impassive as always, I notice a tenseness in his shoulders. Desmond. His name is Desmond. And I haven't set a date yet, but it should be soon. Would you... Victoria trails off when she notices the rest of us. Hello, Rod. Victoria. His tone is surprisingly static. Last time he was here, I was sure he sounded friendlier. So, what can I help you with, Emily? Looking for another doll? Another doll? But Emily is not interested in dolls. Oh no, I just came here to see you. I can't stay for long, since Rod has things to do. Emily, I'll wait for you outside. Okay. I know it is my job to follow Emily around, but I am not at all interested in hearing her talk to this girl. Does she even want me here?
I don't think Emily cares either way, let's be real. Emily's like, do what you want.
Let's go outside.
Outside we go. I have to readjust first, hold on.
My leg fell asleep.
There we go. My time is better spent trying to improve Rod's opinion of me. If I could get him to tell me precisely what I've done wrong, I can make up for it. I hope that would give me a good deed. I curtsy at the two girls. Excuse me, Your Highness. I shall wait outside with Rod. I cough to clear my throat. With the prince. Okay, I won't be long. I move to stand next to Rod, who is leaning against the wall. Rod sighs in annoyance. Why do you keep on following me? Tell me how to rectify whatever wrong I have done to your family. This again? I cannot help but scowl at Rod's answer. You spout all this nonsense about goodness, but refuse to help me. How is that good? You haven't given me any reason to help you. What? If you're not serious about genuinely learning how to be good, then I'm not interested in helping you. Maybe I can catch him off guard by bringing up his response in the toy shop just now. Fine. Then I will make normal conversation. Who is Victoria to you? Has she done something to hurt your family too? Victoria is a childhood friend. She is not like you at all. Oh, then why are you acting so cold to her? You obviously did not want to be inside the shop. Rod looks away from me and absently kicks a pebble on the ground. That is none of your business. I sigh, disappointed with Rod's reaction. Rod turns away from me as Emily exits the shop. Ready to go? Emily nods with a small smile. The two of us begin to make our way to the palace again. By the time we turn to the palace, evening has fallen. I hope we're not late for dinner. The minute the carriage doors open, we are greeted by two familiar faces. Oh, fuck. Sir Alicaster and Sir Mythos stand before us. Princess Emily. Prince Rod. I was on my way to look for you when Mythos informed me of your whereabouts. He glares at the knight escort and the knight shrinks back. Sir Alicaster turns sharply to me afterwards, his eyes narrowed. Why is he looking at me like that? Oh, Lucia? No idea. Why is he doing that? It was getting late, and the queen was worried. I'm so sorry. Princess Emily, Prince Rod, it is almost time for dinner. Please, let me escort you inside. Sir Mythos gestures for them to follow him. I am about to follow after them when Sir Alicaster moves to block my path. His eyes are cold. He opens his mouth to say something, but then closes it and shakes his head. You are dismissed, girl. You may go back to your quarters. But that is an order. His gaze is piercing. Even when I was a princess, I was not able to stand up to that gaze. Yes, sir. After dinner, I make my way to the room assigned to me. As I walk down the hall, I notice Rod heading in my direction. Rod? He suddenly grabs my arm and pulls me away, down the hallway. Down the hall. Where are you taking me? Rod does not answer, but continues moving until we reach an unfamiliar door. What is going on? Rod cuts me off by placing a finger on my lips. He looks around warily before finally pulling me through the door with him. This place. I've heard of this place before, but I have never seen it. Is this a secret passage that leads into town? Rod does not answer me. He simply keeps walking, and I see no other option. Night. Sleep well. See ya. And I see no other option but to trail after him. How is it you know this place? He still refuses to answer. Are you deaf? Rod suddenly stops and I bump into his back. I stumble back with a scowl. You ask too many questions. Because you refuse to answer any of them. I glare back at him until Rod makes an exasperated sound. Lady Parfait is the one who told me about this passage. It makes sneaking out of the palace easier. Parfait? She did not give me an explanation of how she knew of this place. There are only meant to be two copies of the keys. The king has one and Sir Alicaster has the other. Then why do you have a key? Don't tell me you stole it from the king. I'm not a thief. Lady Parfait also has a copy. She saw it fit to provide me with a key for my own use. What? How does Parfait have a key to this place? You'll have to ask her that yourself. Once we step into town, I realize where it is we are headed. We're going back to the Marchin. Dolores is the first person we see as soon as we enter the Marchin. Well, well, well. Look at what the cat dragged in. Dolores, you... Rod's glare silences me. He steps forward and points back at me, gaze I see. She is not staying at the palace. What? Dolores raises an eyebrow. Why is that? She works there now. I do not know what game you're playing, but I will not be a part of it. Excuse me? This is not a game. I do not want you meddling in my life as you meddled with hers. The room temperature drops several degrees. Dolores stares at Rod, her expression suddenly lacking any emotion. With all due respect, Your Highness, I do not want to meddle with your wallowing? Whatever. But just because you do not wish to break your curse doesn't mean that others shouldn't want to either. You should be humbled that our princess here thought you would be able to help her. Rod raises an eyebrow. Where's Lady Parfait? Of course you want to talk to Parfait, because she puts things nicely. Fine, I'll fetch her for you. Delora curtsies as she sweeps out of the room. Rod sighs. He clearly looks irritated, but he doesn't put a voice to his agitation. Now that we're alone in the empty room, the silence is deafening. And so I ask him the question that has bothered me since we came here. Why do you not want to break your curse? He's not going to answer that. If he won't even, like, acknowledge it, he is not going to answer that. Why do you want me out of the palace? The further away you are from my family, the better. I glare at him. Your reaction is completely unwarranted. I am here trying to make up for what I've done in the past. Only because you're being forced to. Why should that make any difference? Besides, I am still willing to help you break your curse, even though it appears you do not want to. I do not realize the anger inside of me at first, but then I notice my hands are fists and that I am shaking. You are angry at me for treating your family with unkindness, and yet you do not treat me with any respect or kindness either. Excuse me? I realize that this is the angriest I have felt in a long time, and it makes words fall out of my mouth. You are guilty of the same disrespect you hold me accountable for. We are both being cruel to family, aren't we? Rod's eyes are ablaze as he stalks toward me. He stops right in front of me, his mouth pressed into a firm line. As you are so fond of telling Emily, we do not share any blood. The only thing that pulling us together is the king, and you do not wish to share his morals. Remember this, Lucia. You will never be a part of my family. And I will never see you as a sister. Rod storms out of the reception area just as Delora enters. Sorry, looks like Parfait isn't in. She pauses and then gives me a wary smile. Seems this partnership is going well. I throw my hands up in anger. He is infuriating! Not as helpful as you thought? I was surprised you were asking for his help in the first place. All I've been doing today is following around Emily, and he still finds reasons to snap at me. In his eyes, I can do nothing right, even though I am making an honest effort to break my curse. Delora eyes me as she slides down into a chair. Has he told you anything about his curse? Nothing useful. Delora sighs. Boys can be so secretive about the silliest things. Rod has been aware of how to break his curse from the very beginning. Then why hasn't he broken it? I have no idea. I think the only other person who knows the full terms and conditions of Rod's curse is Parfait. Parfait? Parfait has known Rod for a while. She convinced him to keep coming to March and even after he gave up on breaking his curse. Parfait also thinks that working with you will convince Rod to try finding another way to break his curse. Another way? Don't ask me. I don't know much about his curse either. But if you keep trying, you might convince Rod to talk. I doubt that very much. It seems that all I am doing is convincing Rod that I do not deserve to break my own curse. Dorlara looks at me curiously for a few minutes, then she grins. I have an idea. If this is another terrible idea... No. Oh, no, no, no. This is one's much better. I'll just stick around with you. You know, watch out for you. What? Delora, watch out for me. Doll! We're getting Doll Delora back! Yay! Doll Delora is so pretty. I'm so happy to have her back. I'm surprised when Delora suddenly stands before me in her doll form. There's no way you and Rod are going to sort yourselves out without some kind of help, so I will be tagging along. It's much easier when I'm Travis-sized, Why do I feel like she's only going to make things worse? Come on, then. You know what's crazy? When Delora, who isn't the biggest fan of Luciette, and clearly finds Luciette a bit of a brat, is somehow on her side against Rod. Like, Delora hates Rod more than she hates Luciette, and that is impressive. To be fair, she doesn't hate either of them. She just very much dislikes their current attitudes. Delora somehow manages to jump in the front pocket of my apron, which is thankfully large enough to fit her doll body. Let us find a prince and get ourselves back to the palace. Step four. One step forward. Two steps back.
That's the full quote, so...
It's been more than a week since Rod and I returned to the margin. He has been avoiding me ever since that day. Not that we have much cause to be around each other nowadays. I'm constantly on my feet preparing for Emily's ball. This is ridiculous. Better to be busy than bored, princess. I sat for a moment to better balance the pile of fabrics that I am carrying. One of the maids has ordered me to bring this to a designated room so it can be sorted out. I am being reduced to fetching and carrying, and I have made no progress on accomplishing my first good deed. I doubt that simply following orders from the other maids will help me get my first good deed. I feel a shuffling in my pocket, and then notice Dolora peeking her porcelain face out. Better to obey rather than disobey, at least. You're not going to get a good deed being stubborn. Anyway, you've got to put yourself out there a bit more, princess. You can't just do whatever is convenient for you. That's not good. Dolora has been no help at all. Of course not. Wait, I recognize this place. Isn't this where your room is? I stop in front of the door to my old bedroom. Ever since I came here, I have been ignoring this room, not wanting to see what the king did to it during my absence. Do you not want to go in? Why should I? It's not as if it's my room anymore. Oh, you're no fun. Aren't you curious about how it's changed? I'd be lying if I said I wasn't. I guess a little peek would not hurt. I step into the room and close the door behind me. It's like stepping into the past. The room is exactly as I left it. It seems completely untouched. Moments later, Dolora is standing before me in her human form. It looks like someone's been dusting in here. Strange, considering no one should remember who this room even belongs to. I glance around, eyes wide. Everything looks the same. I put the fabrics I'm carrying down on my bed and make my way to the shelf where my dolls are displayed. My eyes pause on a specific doll. This one was not here before. Dolora raises an eyebrow. Maybe you don't remember that one because she wasn't very memorable? You do have a lot of dolls after all. No, I know each of my dolls by name. This one is definitely new. She looks very similar to the dolls I saw at Victoria's shop. I quickly turn at the sound of the doorknob. My eyes move to Dolora, but she's already turned into a doll and tucked herself into a corner of the shelf with the rest of my dolls. Emily stands in the doorway, eyeing me curiously. Lucia, what are you doing here? I made a mistake. I thought I was supposed to bring these fabrics here. I hope she does not see through my eye. Emily shakes her head, smiling. It is not your fault, Lucia. You are still getting used to the palace, and it has many rooms. I got lost here all the time when I first arrived. Mm-hmm. This room is interesting, though. Father expressly ordered that it be kept clean, but otherwise undisturbed. Why would he say that? He won't say why, but apparently this room is very special to him. Maybe it belonged to someone he cherished. Cherished? What a joke. Still, I cannot help but feel hope at her suggestion. I don't think Father would like either of us being here. We should leave soon. I only came here to put a ribbon on one of the dolls. One of the dolls. Yes, I put one of my dolls here. She walks past me and picks up the doll I did not recognize. I bought this. I know Emily always visited Victoria, but I did not think she liked dolls. She always preferred receiving and buying books. So why does she have this doll? Do you like dolls? Well, I mean, I don't mind them, but I don't buy them for myself, no. Then why did you buy this one? Emily looks at the doll with a sad smile and shakes her head. I'm not sure. I bought it as a gift. I remember that much. I was going to give it to someone who liked dolls. Someone I wanted to befriend. I don't know why, but it feels right to leave the doll here until I can remember whom I was meant to give her to. Emily is silent for a moment before she turns to me with a bright smile. I know you have a delivery to make, but can you come, but could you come with me to the palace entrance first? Mother's still busy talking with the cooks, so the fabrics can wait. I resist the urge to glare at her. She better not be dragging me around to do more errands. I'm expecting delivery, and I might need your help. I thought so. I have no choice but to nod. Of course. I begrudgingly follow Emily toward the entrance, and there I see a delivery carriage. A familiar person stands beside it. Ah, Victoria! Emily pulls Victoria into a tight hug. I turn my attention away to glare at the number of boxes at the back of the carriage. I have no doubt I will no doubt have to help carry them inside. How are the preparations for the ball coming? Emily's smile seems forced at first, but then eases into something softer. It's going well, I suppose. How's the wedding? Desmond and I have finalized the date. It'll be 2 days after your ball. I can't wait to see you in your wedding dress. Those two always talk so much when they get together. I ignore their chatter as I walk up to the carriage to observe the boxes piled inside. What is in the boxes? Oh. Victoria reaches out to grab one. She hands it to me. I'm helping with the ball decorations. I came by with part of the order today. Part of it? Careful, it's a bit heavy. I take the box from her hands and reassemble. This is heavy. Emily should have the male servants do this. Queen Ophelia placed quite a large order. I brought the more fragile decorations first. Oh, the glass... Hold on. Babbles? I have to look these up because I swear this seems familiar to me. I don't know how the hell to say it. But it feels familiar. Images. Oh yeah, no, these. Oh. Ornaments. They're freaking ornaments. But they have such a fancy name for whatever reason. That's why they feel familiar. I bet I've looked it up before and just like was confused on why. Well, now we know. I grit my teeth and as I shift the box in my arms and attempt to make it easier to hold. I thought you worked at a toy shop. Yes, but we also have aisles dedicated specifically to party decorations. What kind of toy shop is that? Luciette, will you be alright? I feel annoyance shimmer within me. I'm obviously not alright. Emily reaches out to help with the box, but she is too late. I've only taken one step forward when the box slides and I stumble. I manage to cradle in my arms, but its weight is too much for me. Before I hit the ground, I feel strong arms pull my waist, pulling me back upright. The box is taken from me. My heart and mind are racing, and for a moment I cannot comprehend what has just happened. Are you alright? Rod? I glance aside and am shocked to see Rod standing there. The expression on his face gives nothing away, but our close distance, I see some flicker of emotion in his bright eyes. Concern. I am... Luciette, I am so sorry. Are you okay? Rod pushes me, and I stumble forward, almost tripping on the ground. He raises an eyebrow at me. Know your limits, Luciette. I glare at him as anger begins to bubble in my chest. Stay silent. Because Amelia's there. We can't say shit because Amelia's there, and Amelia doesn't know, so... We just gotta be quiet here. I clench my fist and take a deep breath to try and calm myself. I will not stoop to his or that. Yeah, that's... He is the one being cruel here, not me. You shouldn't have stubbornly tried to carry something that was too heavy for you. I will not take any responsibility if you get hurt. Rod, you shouldn't be angry with her for trying to help me. It was my fault for giving her something so heavy. Victoria, what are you doing here? Rod's voice is still cold, and Victoria looks startled by his tone. I came here to deliver some of the decorations for the ball. And you thought Emily and her maid could carry these things on their own. Ra, this isn't her fault. I'm the one who chose to bring Lucyette with me. I underestimated the size of the delivery. Victoria was just delivering the supplies. At least she admits her mistakes. I never thought Rod would be so stubborn. Emily's expression softens as she looks at her brother. She looks sad. Rod ignores her and picks up the box that I had been carrying. He begins to walk away before he stops and glances back at me. Come on. Rod? We're going to call some servants to carry these boxes in. He turns around and begins to walk away. I am Emily's personal maid, not his. I glance at Emily, who nods her head. I really am so sorry. Thank you for helping my brother, Lucyette. I curtsy ever so slightly before running after Rod. Rod, wait! He picks up his pace as if trying to lose me. I turn the corner, barely stopping myself before running right into Rod's back. What now? Why are you so angry at me today? I've barely even spoken to you. Your mere presence is enough to darken my mood. I glare at him across my arms. Funny, you call me cruel, but right now you are worse than I ever was. I don't need someone who hasn't even managed a single good deed to lecture me. I have to try very hard to resist the urge to slap him. You were supposed to help me get a good deed. As I said before, I never agreed to this. I still refuse to help you. Rod starts walking again, and I hurry after him. I cannot help but recall how cold he was with Victoria earlier. I thought they were friends, but he treated her like this at the toy shop, too. Why were you so angry with Victoria earlier? No reason. I raise an eyebrow when Rod quickly answers the question. Then you were cold for no reason. You have such a princely disposition. Rod frowns, but has no rebuttal for my words. You must be generally cold and unfriendly. Excuse me? That would explain why you treated Victoria as you did. I had thought that you two were childhood friends. But Victoria was always closer to Emily than with me. We may have been friendly once, but we've since become distant. Distant? It is none of your business. I pause as we pass my door, remembering that I left both the fabrics and Dolora inside. I make my way toward the door and open it. What are you doing? None of your business. Enjoyed your field trip? I frown when I see her sitting on my bed in human form. What would you have done if it wasn't me? Us witches have a sense for these things. Dolora? Rod slowly enters the room. It's nice to see you here, Lady Dolora. Huh? Sebby? Nice to see you too, little Sebby. Why are you here? Dolora shrugs as she inspects her nails. I thought I would help the princess here, since someone doesn't seem very willing. Rod furrows his eyebrows at her. I didn't... Yes, I know. You didn't sign up for this. But do you really think you have a choice, Rod? Dolora looks at Rod pointedly. You know the consequences if this fails. Rod looks away, expression conflicted. Consequences? What are you talking about? Consequences for not helping me with my curse? Rod sighs heavily before turning back to Dolora. He does not pay attention to me. I am not the right person for this. It doesn't matter what you think. The princess thought you were, so suck it up and do your job. Rod is silent for a few moments before he finally faces me, looking resigned. I will help you then, but do not expect me to change my opinions of you. I shrug at him. It's not like I was expecting you to in the first place. Dolora grins with clear triumph. Good talk. Rod sighs. In order to achieve your good deeds, you're going to need to mend what you broke before. I feel I already know what he's going to say. My sister has always wanted to be your friend, so you must do just that. Show her kindness, and you may be able to get your first good deed through her. Show her kindness, huh? Dolora decides to stay in my room for the time being, saying that she believes Rod will be able to help me for now. Later, I make my way to the dining room with the fabrics and see Amelia and Felia inside. Lucyette! Ah, I see you have the fabric. Thank you. Ophelia takes the topmost sample of the fabric and begins to inspect it as Amelia walks up to me. Where's Rod? He returned to his studies. Oh, right. He has history lessons today, and I am yet to finish my history homework, which is due tomorrow. As Amelia muses aloud, I ponder what Rod told me earlier. I must become Amelia's friend. But is that really a good deed? I hope Rod didn't send the servants out before he went back to his room. I wanted to tell him that Victoria and I already called on the guards to bring the boxes inside. Maybe he decided to start his lessons earlier so that he can make your dance lessons this evening. Dance lesson? Father wanted to hire the best dance instructor in Angelia, but honestly, I feel more comfortable with Rod teaching me. He is a good dancer, so Father has allowed it. That is a surprise. I did not know Rod could dance. He used to prefer singing, but then... Ophelia trails off, and I know she's talking about the fairy tale curse, but I not expect her to divulge such information to a maid like myself. He has decided to focus on his dancing for the past few months. Ophelia glances down at the fabrics, then looks up and smiles at me. Lucia, would you mind helping me with this? I immediately walk over to the fabrics Ophelia wants me to look through. They are apparently samples for the tablecloth that will be used during the ball. This is going to be a long day. Rod comes immediately to the throne room after his history lessons to start on his dance lessons with Emily. I am only standing here because it is my responsibility as her personal maid to watch over her as she practices. I watch as she steps out of rhythm and Rod sighs at her. You're doing it wrong. That's the 10th time. Sorry. Again. They start from the beginning, and I am unable to stifle my own sigh when Amelia messes up the same step again. This would make the 11th time. I really am terrible at this. Would you rather have the royal dance instructor teach you? He has more experience teaching than I do. No, I really do want you to teach me, Rod. I'm sorry, I'm such a slow learner. You're always good at everything. Singing, dancing, cooking. Prince Rod cooks? Yes, Rod does cook. He's very good at it. You didn't have to tell her that, Em. Does it really matter? I love bragging about how talented my little brother is. I see a tinge of pink on Rod's cheeks as he turns away. Is he embarrassed? Emily looks down at the floor, her smile smaller. I wish I was as talented as you, Rod. I always thought Emily had been overly optimistic. She always seemed to bounce back with a smile no matter how many times I pushed her away. Now I can't help but reconsider that thought. Still, seeing her like this only irritates me. Pitying yourself will get you nowhere. Not everyone can be perfect at everything when they first start out. I remember when Mother gave me similar lessons. She was always such a harsh teacher. She hated it when I showed weakness in front of her. She made me keep practicing until I had perfected whatever it was she wanted me to do. Failure was never an option. I never had time for self-pity. Instead of feeling sorry for yourself, just try harder. Let failure inspire you to do better. Lucia, that was... She's right, Rod. Instead of complaining, I should be working harder. I let out an exasperated sigh and crossed my arms. You always look at your feet whenever you reach the underarm turn. Instead, focus on counting your steps and let Prince Rod lead you. Worrying too much on your next step is what puts you off rhythm. Emily stares at me. Can you dance, Luciette? I can. Why? Wow, that's amazing! There's nothing amazing about me being able to dance. Her praise makes me embarrassed, regardless. Maybe I can learn faster seeing someone else do the dance first. Em, what are you talking about? It might be easier to copy the steps if someone performed them first. She turns to me suddenly, her eyes bright. Would you help me? I meant to assist Amelia in any way that I can, but dancing with her brother? Surely a lowly maid should not be doing this.
That is a good point. That is a very good point.
If we accept, I feel like that's gonna make him hate us more. Right? Because Rod's an asshole.
So I suppose we should just refuse.
Even if I do agree, I doubt Rod would even want to dance with me. You cannot learn how to dance by watching someone. You have to practice the steps yourself. But if you need a break, you can just say so, Em. Not really. I find it easier learning through visuals. Sorry for making you uncomfortable, Lucyette. Let's continue our practice, Rod. Amelia smiles at me, but it is obvious that she looks more disheartened now. Rod looks at his sister before shaking his head. He turns to walk towards me and he holds out his hand. Would you dance with me?
What?
Rod leans closer to me and speaks in a low voice. Play along. This is just for Emily. He's actually curious about your dancing, princess. Sebi! Every time Sebi shows up, I love him. I adore him. I'm surprised when Sebi suddenly whispers to me. I can tell it's Sebi by the change in the pitch of his voice. Oops. Sorry, Rod. Rod glares at Sebi before looking at me again. Well? I shift my gaze to Emily, who is practically beaming. I sigh and take Rod's hand. I know Emily does not like treating me as a maid, but this is a little too much. Fine. Just this once.
There is no passion in this whatsoever. There is just utter hate. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear.
I put my hand on his shoulder, and he places his hand on the small of my back. Rod looks at me, but quickly averts his gaze. Is something wrong? I didn't think I would ever have to dance with you, is all. Neither did I. Rod looks at me again. This time he has an uncomfortable scowl on his face. He's not the only uncomfortable one here. We both start to dance, and I mentally count the steps. It has been a long time since I last danced with anyone, but the steps come to me naturally. The dance is rather simple. While Rod and I move stiffly, I cannot help but notice his careful footwork. I realize that Rod really is a pretty decent dancer. Of course, I would never openly admit that. When we stop, I hear Emily clapping her hands as she looks at both of us in awe. You really are a good dancer. Thank you so much for showing me the steps. Now I know for sure what to do during that part. I shrug at her before stepping back into the corner. Emily takes her position in front of Rod once more. This time she has a bright smile on her face. I cannot believe something as simple as that made her so happy. At the end of the day, Emily has managed to do the steps correctly. She tells me many times how grateful she is for the help. After practice, I return to my room and retire to bed. I think about how happy Emily was. How can such a small thing make a person so happy?
Oi! No! It's the bitch!
Oh no. You stepped out of rhythm again, Lucyette. But mother, this is really hard. A princess never complains. You must perfect this waltz by tomorrow. Otherwise, I will not allow you to play with your dolls for the day. Oh no. Oh no, especially because Lucyette's dolls is like the most important thing to her. But if you have time for objections, you have time to push yourself harder. Now, once again, from the top. Hi, Rod. The following days are uneventful. Emily continues her dance lessons with Rod. Her steps are far from perfect, but I can tell that she has improved since my demonstration with Rod. Meanwhile, Rod still chooses to ignore me most of the time, though I have noticed he is less cold than usual. At least he does not snap at me for no good reason anymore. Though Dolora is no longer assisting me, she insists on staying in my room more often.
She says that there is something important she wants to investigate, and I cannot even guess what it might be. I prefer not having her around anyway. Her constant chattering makes it difficult to focus on anything. Right now, I'm trying to figure out how I can achieve my first good deed. Almost 3 months have passed since I was first cursed, but I have yet to complete my first good deed. These are my thoughts. I am heading back to my sleeping quarters after dinner that night. Emily excused me long ago, insisting that I go on to my own room before she went to hers. I am walking down the hallway when I notice Rod heading down a familiar path. I follow after him. Are you going to the Marchin? Rod jumps and turns around. The surprise on his face quickly fades into annoyance. Don't do that again. And no, not today. Since I came here, I found out Rod occasionally sneaks out of the palace at night through the secret passageway to get to the Marchin. Even now, I am still confused on why he goes there. He said before he had given up on breaking his curse, which makes me wonder why he still visits. It also makes me wonder why he would refuse to break his curse in the first place. Is he okay with being the way that he is? Or is this curse just really difficult to break?
It's both.
Why were you cursed, Rod? I am not answering that question. Why? I cannot help you break your curse if you refuse to tell me anything. I told you before I do not need your help. But I chose you as my partner. You help me, I help you. It is highly likely that breaking Rod's curse will also count for a good deed. Rod scowls at me and crosses his arms. I'm afraid that this isn't how this works at all. The sound of footsteps keeps me from coming back with a retort. We both turn to see Sir Alcaster approaching us. Prince Rod, good evening.
Good evening, Sir Alcaster.
Sir Alcaster turns to me and raises an eyebrow. Shouldn't you be attending Princess Emily? Rod silenced me with a look. He moves to stand in front of me, shielding me from Sir Alcaster's gaze. We were just about to go to her. Let's go, Luciette. Rod strides away, and I quickly curtsy at Sir Alcaster before falling after Rod. I can still feel Sir Alcaster's eyes on my back as I walk away. I try my best to suppress a shudder. Rod and I walk through the hallway in silence. We both stop in our tracks when we hear the clattering of silverware. I turn around and realize... Where is it? There it is. Come on. Boop. Realize the sound has come from behind a set of doors that are slightly open. The dining hall. Oh no! That's Emily's voice. We do not see Emily when we enter the room, but there is a dizzying array of cutlery set out on the table. Emily. Emily surprises us both by crawling out from beneath the table. She flashes us an embarrassed smile as she gets to her feet, holding several forks and knives in her hands. What are you doing here? You should be getting ready for bed. Sorry. I had the silverware on the table. I thought I could practice before I sleep today. It has already been an incredibly long day for her, and yet she is still doing this. I watch as Emily puts the cutlery back at the table. Onto the table in the wrong places. You need to rest, Em. I will, after I practice the placement one last time. She smiles at him before returning to the table. I don't know why a person would need so much cutlery. One fork, one spoon, and one knife should be more than enough for any meal. And all these glasses, if I recall correctly, this one is for water, this one is for red wine, this one is for white wine.
Pointing out her mistakes is going to make her feel bad.
Correct answer? Yeah, let's just give her the correct answers. The flute is for champagne. The other one is for sherry. Oh, right. But there are two more. The other is for juice, and the other glass is for dessert wine. Dessert wine glass will only be used during the dessert course. And the juice glass is only used when juice is being served as a course. Otherwise, it is placed next to the water goblet. I see. I see Rod staring at me with the corner of his eyes. His lips twitch before he turns back to his sister. It looked like he was about to smile. What are these for?
We got a thing. Emily points out the gap of forks in front of her. Use those every day, Your Highness. You should know the answer. Emily points at them as she rattles off names. Dinner fork, fish fork, salad. Correct. You know so much about etiquette, too. You're really incredible, Luciette.
You make a better noblewoman than I do. Oh, if you knew. If you knew the half of it.
Even if I told her I was a noble, it's not as if she would believe me. I just read a lot about all these things. You read and know enough to put them into practice? That's amazing! Especially since you haven't been with us so long, right, Rod? Rod shrugs. He does not, much to my surprise, disagree. Perhaps you should be my teacher, Luciette. I can learn so quickly from you. Emily quickly straightens out the cutlery. Now that I think about it, I've come to realize that Emily is much more than she appeared to be. It is probably because I am forced to spend so much time with her as her maid. She is different. She is flawed, not as conceited, and more humble than I originally thought. Maybe I should try lending her a hand. I may not be one of your tutors, but if you need help with your lessons, just ask me and I will do what I can for you. Luciette? I glance at Rod, who is once again wearing an expression of surprise. I shift my attention to Emily once again. You only have 1 month left to prepare, and as your personal maid, I feel it is my responsibility to help you in whatever ways I can. Luciette. Amelia wipes her eyes with the back of her hand, and that's when I notice something glistening on her cheek. Is she crying? You're extremely kind, Luciette. Thank you. I will definitely take you up on that offer. I am still looking at Emily when I catch a faint glow coming from the pendant on my chest. What just happened? Oh, what a pretty necklace you have, Luciette. Thank you. Anyway, for now I think both of us would benefit from some sleep. After escorting Emily back to her room, I walk out of the hallway in a daze. What was that light? It seems like you actually managed to obtain your first good deed. I did not know he was still here. I look down at my pendant, astonished at what I see. We got the heel. A piece of the glass slipper. I gingerly touch the new piece that is hanging next to my existing glass slipper pendant. It is real. Not too bad after all. Did he just compliment me? What? Rod turns away. Nothing. He walks away, leaving me alone with my thoughts. Secrets! Oh no! No! I was not expecting a dream sequence! No! Leave my baby girl alone! Good morning, Your Highness. Would you like to play with us? You want to play with me? Yeah, come play with us. We'll have lots of fun. Well, please, just for a little while. Maybe I can. Luciette, what are you doing here in front of the gates? Mother. Good morning, Your Majesty. We were just wondering if the princess wants to come play with us. No, Princess Luciette does not want to play with you. But Mother, I do. Enough idle chatter. We must go. It's time for your dance lessons. But, Luciette, do not make me repeat myself. Yes, Mother. God, I hate her mother so much. Ugh. It is still dawn when I wake up. As much as I want to continue sleeping, I have no choice but to get up and prepare for the day. The last thing I need is an annoying lecture from the head maid. I've almost become accustomed to waking up this early, even if I do not enjoy it. As soon as my preparations are made, I begin to make my way toward Emily's room, should she wake early. I am about halfway there when I hear familiar voices. Standing far ahead of me are Sir Alicaster and Sir Mythos. Are you sure this is going to work? Have a little faith in me, my friend. Friends. We are not friends. Sir Alicaster narrows his eyes, and then turns abruptly to look at me. Ah, Miss Luciette, was it? Sir Mythos, Sir Alicaster. Have you been eavesdropping, child? He has no reason to be angry at me. If they were talking about something confidential, they should not have been openly talking in the hallway. I am on my way to Princess Emily's room, sir. That is why I am here. I coolly look at Sir Alcaster, who looks like he is about to pop a vein. I cannot yet but feel satisfied at his reaction. In a few moments, he is suddenly looming over me. I've never seen Sir Alcaster look so angry before. What is going on? Rod is walking towards us with a scowl on his face. Sir Alcaster notices this and quickly steps back. There was just a little misunderstanding, Your Highness. Rod glances at me, his eyes narrowing. Great, I'm sure he's going to blame me for this too, even though I did nothing. Much to my surprise, Rod puts himself between me and Sir Alcaster. Are you alright, Lucyette? He is worried about me. I slowly nod. Rod turns back to Sir Alcaster and Mithros. If you do not have any business with Lucyette, I will be taking her with me. Emily is already waiting for her. Sir Alcaster stares at me a few moments before bowing down to Rod. Of course, Your Highness. Thank you. Rod turns to me again, his expression solemn. Shall we? He walks off before waiting my reply. I look back at Sir Alcaster and Sir Mithros one last time before chasing after him. What's that, Rod? The both of us spend the next few minutes walking in silence. Rod has not said a thing since my encounter with Sir Mithros and Sir Alcaster. Are you okay? What? He has already asked me this before. You already asked me that before. Was he really worried? That is a great question. Are we okay? Well, the thing is, we have knowledge. I have knowledge. But in this playthrough, Lucyette does not have knowledge. So, I'm fine. Nothing dangerous was gonna happen. I'm surprised to see the look on Rod's face at my response. His expression is soft, somewhat like his usual scowl. Rod here is pretty worried about you, princess. Rod glares at Sebi, his cheeks tinged pink. Sebi chuckles. Sorry, Rod. Your thoughts ring so loudly in your brain that I can't help but say them aloud. This is not the first time Sebi has told me what Rod is thinking. Rod reaches out and pinches Sebi's face, his scowl returning. Ow, 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 I'm sorry, okay? But next time, try not to think too loudly. You said that Emily was waiting for me. I did not expect her to be up so early. Where is she? I lied. What? He lied to help me out of that situation? Why are you helping me? Because while you are here, you are my responsibility. I may loathe the role, but I will still uphold it. Besides, you don't need a reason to help someone in need. Help someone in need. I remember Parfait and Deloria telling me before that being good often involves helping others who are in need. Now that I have helped you, I'll be taking my leave now. I have fencing lessons to attend. Rod starts to walk off, but then stops and turns back to me. Don't get yourself into more trouble. I won't be there all the time to save you. I glare at him across my arms. I am not some damsel in distress, Your Highness. I do not need your help. Rod snores before turning away from me and walking away. Later that day, I watch Emily finish her etiquette lessons. I can tell that the teacher is impressed with her progress. Emily is able to correctly name all the glasses and cutlery. She is not so slow a learner. I had come here earlier in the day to better teach Emily about proper dining etiquette. It turns out that my lesson was valuable. You've shown great improvement, Your Highness. I'm glad that you have been diligent with your studies. No doubt you'll be ready for the ball soon. Emily smiles, her cheeks turning pink. Thank you. I wouldn't have done it without the help of a friend. Emily glances at me briefly and smiles gently. I really owe her a lot. That is wonderful. I am glad you have such a dedicated friend, Your Highness. Friend? Is that really what I am to her? But princesses do not have maids as friends. A royal does not mingle with commoners, especially not with servants. Mother told me that before. Emily does not treat me as a maid, but she cannot possibly think of me as a friend. After the teacher gives Emily several books to study for their next lesson, she ends the lesson and excuses herself. Emily approaches me and grasps my hands. Thank you so much, Lucette. I wouldn't have passed without your help. All I did was repeat the things your teacher taught you. But you're different. I raise an eyebrow at her. Different. I tend to get nervous in my lessons. My teachers are strict and intimidating. I cave beneath the pressure. But with you, well, I feel more comfortable around you. It's probably because we're almost the same age and your lessons feel more casual. So thank you. I'm very grateful to you. She looks down at the ground shyly. I hope it is all right that we are friends. I furrow my eyebrows at her. Why would you even want to be friends with a maid? You're supposed to be making friends with nobles, not the servants. Emily frowns, and I can feel her deflate. She walks towards the window and sighs. I tried. They may not say anything, but I can feel them silently judging me. I wasn't born a princess, and I feel that they judge everything I do. They think that I smile too much, that I'm not regal enough. They feel that I'm too clumsy or too cheerful. Well, Emily definitely does not act like a noble. I cannot say I blame the nobles for being skeptical of her. Being with them suffocates me. I do my best to act like a princess, but the way they all look at me, it's as if they're waiting for me to make a mistake. Then they'll all have an excuse to jeer at me. This is so interesting too, because Lucette's big thing is that all the, you know, common folk judge her, and despise her, right? And for Emily, it's the opposite. She believes all the nobles judge her and despise her, while the common folk agree with her. Granted, in Lucette's case, I don't think the nobles liked her either. But it's interesting how much opposites they are, despite having technically right now the same role. Every girl dreams of becoming a princess, and yet this is not my dream. I really just miss being a normal girl. I miss my freedom. I look at her, thoughtful. I think I can understand what Emily is feeling. Just like me, she was thrown into a world she was not ready to be a part of. Right now, we have no choice but to fit in. She never wanted my title in the first place, yet I accused her of stealing it. Have you told your mother how you feel? Emily shakes her head. No, not the king either. I don't want them to think that I'm ungrateful. That's why I'm trying my best to become accustomed to all of this. I cross my arms. But you are not happy. I'm not. Everyone just assumes I'm happy because I smile a lot. She barely opens up to anyone, and yet she opened up to me. Had I been given the choice before I was cursed, I would have never listened to her. You should tell them how you feel, rather than just keep it to yourself. Otherwise, the stress will continue to accumulate on your shoulders. I wish I could be more honest with them. I really do. I envy you for being able to speak your mind. She envies me. Emily takes a deep breath and sighs. The frown fades with a sigh, and is quickly replaced with a fragile smile. I'm sorry for ranting to you like that. I must have bored you with my story. I used to get so annoyed with her, but now that I've seen this side of her, I suppose she is not as terrible as I had first thought. Oh, I remember that mother wanted to see me after my lessons today. Allow me to escort you to the queen, then. Thank you.
Hello, Red. Transition.
Days pass without any real conflict. I run into Sir Alicaster again in the hallways, but his eyes pass over me as if I am something to be ignored. Delora, who had been ignoring me, as she had been busy with other priorities, returned to the march in yesterday to discuss something important with Parfait. It's not as if she's been any help since she came. To be fair, she hasn't. She really hasn't. She mostly stays in my room while I run around doing errands for Emily and taking on other chores as they are handed to me. Right now, I'm headed to the palace gates as I hurry to meet Emily. She's going to town to meet Victoria again, and I was told to meet her here. Lucette. Oh, fuck. Hi, Fitz! Like, dude, I love you, but this is not the time. I turn around to see Fitz walking in my direction. Ever since I told him not to refer to my name, refer to me by my name, he has been stumbling over not using my title. I rarely see him, but when I do, we do not have much time to discuss anything. Can I help you with anything, Fitz? It's been a while. Have you managed to complete one of your good deeds? Days after I had originally ran into Fitz, I managed to have a quick conversation with him regarding my curse. It has been a long time since that conversation happened. Recently, I've barely seen Fitz. I hear rumors that he's been reassigned somewhere outside the palace. I show him my pendant and point at the piece of the second glass slipper. I managed to get one several days ago. Lucette, that's wonderful! I knew that you could get one. Leave it to Fitz. Homeboy, since day one, believed Lucette had good in her. Day one, believed in Lucette. And he didn't even, like, know about the curse or whatnot. I love Fitz, man. I'm so sad you died in Karma's route. I forgot that happened. I might have intentionally blocked it out of my brain because I adore you so much.
Only two more, and then I can break Only two more, and then I can break this curse. Ah, Fitz. Miss Lucette. Shit. I did not think that the two of you were acquainted. We both turn our heads at the same time when Mythos suddenly appears from around the corner, the usual smile on his lips. Sir Mythos. Fitz, I believe Sir Alicaster is looking for you. Right. Sorry. Lucette. I must take my leave now. Of course. Fitz bows to Sir Mythos before walking off, leaving me alone with Sir Mythos. Yeah, I said that right. Mythos does not say anything, but continues to smile at me. His staring makes me feel incredibly uncomfortable. Is there something on my face? Excuse me. I curtsy and start to walk off when Sir Mythos calls my name. Lucette. Yes. I just wanted to thank you for your hard work and dedication to our princess. I look at him, puzzled by his sudden gratitude. Don't worry. Everything will soon be remedied. Excuse me? My apologies. I did not mean to keep you. He completely ignores my question. He dips his head slightly before turning and walking away, the smile still on his face. What was that all about? Rod and Emily are already waiting for me outside the carriage by the time I arrive at the palace gates. Rod has his arms crossed and looks at me, irritable. His face is perpetually stuck in that scowl, it seems. You are late. My apologies. You're so grumpy, but you've been late many times before too, Rod. Rod just shrugs his shoulders as he turns and heads into the carriage. Emily sighs before looking at me. Shall we? Of course. The three of us sit in silence as the carriage rolls down toward the town. The knight assigned to guard duty is sitting out front with the driver, watching for any disturbances. Emily glances forlornly out one window while Rod silently looks out the other as he rests his chin on the palm of his hand. I notice Emily pausing to glance at Rod every now and then, looking restless. Finally, she breaks the silence. Are you still mad I asked you to come along to visit Victoria? You could have declined the invitation, Rod. And if you would only tell me what happened between you two, I would do my best to remedy the situation. Rod notices me looking at him and scowls, who returns his moody gaze to the window. I have nothing to say, Em. But you used to be good friends with Victoria too, Rod. But ever since you were... Emily stops herself, and I know that she is referring to his curse. After that day, you kept your distance from her. Then, when you found
out about the wedding, you became even colder toward her. Even Victoria is worried about you, Rod. She worries that she might have offended you somehow. Emily, there's a hint of warning in his tone. Is it possible Victoria is related to Rod's curse, considering the timing? Emily opens her mouth again to say something, but then suddenly stops and returns to the window, her expression mirroring Rod's own gloom. We're all silent until we arrive at the toy shop. Sorry. Emily, good to see you again, and you too. Luciette, was it? I nod in acknowledgement. Victoria nods politely at the knight, who stands guard at the shop door. It's just the two of you today? Emily and I turn around, only to see that Rod has indeed vanished. Emily frowns, looking both bewildered and disappointed. He was right behind us. I will go look for him. Thank you, Luciette. As I expected, Rod is leaning against the wall of an alley just outside the toy shop. I don't think he wants to talk. Mans is in a bad mood. He in a bad, bad mood. Stay with him. I can tell by Rod's stiff posture that anything I say to him will fall on deaf ears, so I move to stand next to him instead. I lean against the wall with him. What are you doing? Keeping you company? Rod raises an eyebrow at me. Since when have you ever liked my company? Well, I'd rather be here than stay inside the toy shop and listen to Emily and Victoria talk. So you're not here to try and get me to talk? Well, it's not as if you would answer any of my questions. I've tried forcing you to talk, and I know how ineffective that is. But I will be here if you do want to talk. Rod eyes me suspiciously. Since when do you start listening to others? When you are the personal maid of someone who enjoys talking, you learn to listen. Emily has been happier these past few months. I hate to admit it, but it seems to be because of you. Are you actually praising me? Rod looks away, his cheeks tinted pink. Think whatever you like. I do not know why, but for some reason, I am happy that Rod gave me a compliment. Princess Luciette! Holy shit, Waltz! Rod and I turn at the sound of a familiar voice. Waltz? Oh, my voice cracked like hell there. Hold on. Okay, I think we're good. Ron and I turn at the sound of the familiar voice. Waltz pauses in front of us with a bright smile. Ugh. It's nice to see you again, Princess. Nerine just... Waltz, what are you doing here? I was about to deliver a letter to the prince, but I guess that won't be necessary anymore. A letter? Is Lady Parfait asking for me? Not just you. She wants to see the princess as well. Me? It has been a while since I was last at the Marchin. Is something wrong? They need to discuss something important with the princess. Come to the Marchin tonight. Tonight? But we're already here, so why not now? Walt's eyes shift to our carriage. You are here with Princess Emily, yes? You cannot make her wait too long. What they need to discuss with you is complicated and will take some time to explain. The toy shop door opens, and Emily stands in the doorway as she says her goodbyes to Victoria. Remember, tonight. Those are Walt's last words as he slips back into the crowd. Aw, oh, Waltz. Aw, oh, hun. Aw, oh, my baby boy. There's, like, a lot going on with Waltz that we'll find out later. But every time he shows up in the other routes, I'm just like, hey.
You're not having a fun time, are you? There's a reason. Later.
Emily's visit with Victoria was briefer than I thought it would be. Now all of us are headed back to the palace. Rod has not uttered a word on our way back. I can tell that this is making Emily agitated, as she continues to keep glancing at Rod expectantly. If you have something to say, say it. Emily stares at me. You obviously want to say something to Prince Rod. The only way to get your answers is to ask him directly. Rod does not turn around. It is as if he does not hear me. Emily claps her hands and sighs. Well, I glance at Rod, who still persistently stares out the window, his eyes focused on nothing. He is pretending not to hear us. How immature. Rod. Victoria was sad you weren't there today. She was certain you stayed outside to avoid seeing her. What is going on with you? I'm not in the mood to answer your questions, Em. Emily grips the edges of her dress, her expression becoming more rigid. You've been keeping secrets from us ever since you were cursed. We don't even know why you were cursed or how to help you break it. Wait, the rest of the family doesn't know anything about the circumstances of Rod's curse? I had thought he told them everything, but all they know is that he is cursed. We're a family. We're supposed to help each other through problems. Emily's hands are shaking as she gazes at her brother. The carriage stops, and as soon as the servant opens the door, Emily quickly steps out and rushes back toward the palace. Rod watches her go quietly, his eyebrows furrowed, and he looks guilty. I silently shake my head at him before running after Emily. Emily stands in the hallway with her hands to her chest. She breathes slowly in and out as if she is on the verge of tears. When she notices me behind her, she turns around and wipes her tears with the back of her hand. I'm sorry for storming off like that. I was just very frustrated at Rod. I said something I shouldn't have said back there. If anyone finds out about this, they won't. Your secret is safe with me. Emily flashes me a grateful smile before looking at the sky. One moment, Rod is running down the hallway. The next, he has stopped in front of us and is trying to catch his breath. I'm sorry. I'm sorry too, Rod, but right now I would like to be alone. Of course. I'm sorry, Lucyette, but could you leave me for now? She does not even wait for my answer before walking away, leaving me alone with Rod. You made her cry, Rod.
Damn!
I am fully aware of that. Why are you hiding your curse from your family? You wouldn't understand. I'm doing this to protect them. Protect them? Rod silently shakes his head. They wouldn't understand. Those are the last ominous words Rod speaks before rushing off, leaving me alone in the hall. What happened to him? The hallways are silent at this time of night, as everyone in the palace prepares for bed. I am on my way to our meeting place. Rod told me earlier to wait for him here. I had thought that he would make me go to the merchant by myself after what transpired with Emily, but I was wrong. Emily was so upset today. I've never seen her like this before. I turn my thoughts back to the merchant and to what Walt said earlier. I wonder what Parfait wants to talk with us about. I feel my heart beating erratically against my chest. Why do I feel like something bad is going to happen? I realize that I've been standing in the open for a while. Perhaps I should move. People might find my standing here suspicious. I start walking again, but I'm surprised when I feel a hand close around my wrist and pull me into darkness. I open my mouth, but a hand muffles my scream. Shush! Rod? Rod's gaze is icy. He speaks quietly, but I can feel the anger simmering underneath his words. What if someone saw you just standing there? Have you ever thought how they might get suspicious? His tune is accusatory, that for a moment I cannot find my voice. But then he is right. I should have been more careful. Sorry. Rod stares at me, surprised. What? I never thought I'd hear you apologize. Especially to me. Oh? Well, at least I know how to apologize, unlike you. And why would I have any... Why would I ever have reason to apologize to you? Because you have done nothing but treat me coldly, even though I have done nothing to personally attack you. Ross scowls at me, but does not say anything. Instead, he sighs and takes my hand, pulling me after him. What? Let's go before the guards see us. I have no energy to argue with Rod, so I allow him to pull me along. I'm sorry. What? He apologized to me. Don't make me repeat myself. I did not hear you clearly. If there's one thing I know about you, is that you're not deaf. Of course I'm not. Shh, someone will hear you. I glare at Rod, but he does not respond. Princess, your hand is really warm. Sebi! Baby!
I love Sebi more than I love Rod. Give me Sebi. Let me pursue just Sebi. I can't even pursue Sebi. He's just a stuffed animal, but I want him. He's adorable. I love him.
Rod freezes in place and glares at Sebi, who seems to be shrugging. Your thoughts are too loud, Rod. Through the dim lights, I can see a faint blush on Rod's cheeks. You are blushing. I am not. He lets go of my hand and starts to walk toward the secret passage, with me trailing behind him. We look around to make sure no one is in sight before we both slip inside. I follow closely behind Rod in silence. My eyes move upward to the little little bunny plush hanging on his shoulders. Sebi, I've been wondering, have you ever talked with Rod's family as yourself? Rod suddenly stops and scowls over his shoulder at me. What? I'm asking Sebi, not you. No, I don't, Princess. Rod doesn't want me to talk with others since he thinks that I might say something unnecessary. So much for that, you still speak even when it is unnecessary. In the dim lighting of the tunnel, I think I can see a faint pink in Rod's cheeks, but it's probably a trick of the strange light. Rod is right. Sebi has blurted out his thoughts more than a number of times. Yeah, I agree. You're not doing a very good job. Sebi sighs. Oh, wait, actually. Oh, no. I'm gonna pause here. Because it's late. And I'm getting tired. Yeah. Okay, that was fun. So this, my, I'm sorry, I'm getting tired though. Thanks for your stream, no problem. Good night, everyone. Sleep well. See you Wednesday. Bye.